used to be a finance broker, and about 3 years ago, I discovered that a number of things are very wrong in the banking system and that there is much dishonesty and fraud involved in how bank loans are actually set up. So over the last 3 years, I asked these questions to my bank, and in order not to just base things on hearsay and you know, say I've read it on the internet, we actually put our own house on the line. What we're doing today is shining a light into the justice system of Australia, because so far my investigations and many friends that I have made through this time has revealed that there is not a single ruling in favour of homeowners that even had proven that things weren't quite as they are expected.
Mr. Speaker, I beg to move that this House has considered the subject of money creation and society. The methods of money production in society today are profoundly corrupting in ways which would matter to everyone if they were clearly understood. One of the most memorable quotes about money and banking is usually attributed to Henry Ford. He said, "It's well enough that people of the nation do not understand our banking and monetary system, for if they did, I believe there would be a revolution before tomorrow morning." Well, let's hope we don't have a revolution, Mr. Speaker, because I feel sure we're all Conservatives on this side. How's it done? Well, the process is so simple, the mind is repelled. Whenever a bank makes a loan, it simultaneously creates a matching deposit in the borrower's bank account, thereby creating new money. Many times I've been told that this is ridiculous, even by one employee who'd previously worked for the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation of the United States. The explanation is actually taken from the Bank of England article, Money Creation in the Modern Economy. It seems to me rather hard to dismiss.
Hi there. Did you just catch that? Let's just have a quick replay.
Mr. Speaker, I beg to move that this House has considered the subject of money creation and society. The methods of money production in society today are profoundly corrupting in ways which would matter to everyone if they were clearly understood. One of the most memorable quotes about money and banking is usually attributed to Henry Ford. He said, "It's well enough that people of the nation do not understand our banking and monetary system, for if they did, I believe there would be a revolution before tomorrow morning." Well, let's hope we don't have a revolution, Mr. Speaker, because I feel sure we're all Conservatives on this side. How's it done? Well, the process is so simple, the mind is repelled. Whenever a bank makes a loan, it simultaneously creates a matching deposit in the borrower's bank account, thereby creating new money. Many times I've been told that this is ridiculous, even by one employee who'd previously worked for the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation of the United States. The explanation is actually taken from the Bank of England article, Money Creation in the Modern Economy. It seems to me rather hard to dismiss.
Hi there. My name is Uwe Schaefer. I used to be a finance broker in Perth, Western Australia. About 4 years ago, I came across information just like the one that you've just heard from the UK Parliament. Now, Steve Baker, the Honourable Parliament member in England, he was referring to a document by the Bank of England published in early 2014 in their quarterly bulletin called Money Creation in the Modern Economy. Let me just quote a little bit from it. There are two misconceptions about money creation. One common misconception is that banks act simply as intermediaries, lending out the deposits that savers place with them. You'd imagine like your mum and dad or businesses with their surplus money put it in the bank on term deposits, and we thought that the bank would then lend out that money to basically make more profit from it. No such thing. Another common misconception is that the central bank determines the quantity of loans and deposits in the economy by controlling the quantity of central bank money, the so-called money multiplier approach. Some of us also thought that the banks had put deposits with the central bank in each country. Let's say they put 10% and they were then enabled to multiply that and lent maybe 10 times as much. Now, that was a common, as you read, misconception too. What did I say about money creation in reality? Commercial banks create money in the form of bank deposits by making new loans. When a bank makes a loan, for example, to someone taking out a mortgage to buy a house, it does not typically do so by giving them thousands of pounds worth of banknotes. Instead, it credits their bank account with a bank deposit of the size of the mortgage. Now, in bold, they write, at that moment, new money is created. For this reason, some economists have referred to bank deposits as fountain pen money, created at the stroke of bankers' pens when they approve loans. Now, is that what you thought was going on when you went to get a loan for a car or a house? Did you think that the banks have nothing and by their sheer existence and the position they've put themselves in are able to create money from thin air and pretend to loan you something? I didn't, for sure. 4 years ago I discovered this. I left my career in finance overnight. I used to be probably just like many of you. I used to love the game of finance. I used to love the game of property, developing properties and investing, thinking that, wow, there is some real substance there. As it's turned out, it is all an illusion. That's quite difficult to swallow, isn't it? What happened from there? What happened from there is quite interesting. Over the last 4 years, we as a family have tested all the financial service providers that we had in our life. Credit cards, business loans, car loan, and currently the loan, apparent loan for our home mortgage that we've given to the bank. Now, I just want to set one record straight here. The Bank of England documents talks about when you take out the mortgage. That is probably quite incorrect, and that's actually one of the misunderstandings that upholds this whole system. And the furphy behind all this is that you don't take out a mortgage. You apply for a loan. The bank makes an offer to make a loan, and in turn, you give a mortgage, which is the security that the bank requires in their books and in their structure, should you ever not make those payments, so they can then move in on you and steal your property. So you give a mortgage, and more importantly, alongside the mortgage, there's one more thing that you give. It's called an irrevocable power of attorney. What is the power of attorney? It's basically handcuffs. Because when you sign an irrevocable power of attorney, and make no mistake, the banking system knows this very well, and so does the judiciary. When you sign the irrevocable power of attorney, which, try to Google it, it's actually quite difficult to find. This has been so well hidden, the fact that under an irrevocable power of attorney, the bank literally becomes you. They can actually act in your name and do dealings with the property without your knowledge, because you've just given them full-on, open slather permission to do whatever they please. Did you know that? Now, so what if, on the one hand, they have not even provided anything of value to you, because we've just learned by the Bank of England, which, as Steve Baker says, can hardly be dismissed, that they don't have anything to lend, and that actually your signature is the event that creates the funds that then come back to you. In reality, it should be your energy versus a credit to an account system should balance itself out, should it not? Instead, we are blinded and deceived into a system that says, oh, the bank's actually given us a loan. Remember, banks are owned by private people who have constructed this structure a long time ago. Right now, we're in the midst of it. So what happened to us over the last couple of years? Let me share with you. Today, I am convening a court of public opinion. Very simple. For 2 years, we have been in the court system in the highest level in Western Australia at the Supreme Court. In 2012, we realised that none of those alleged lenders that we dealt with in our life on a day-to-day basis would ever give us any information. We had asked numerous questions the 2 years prior, since becoming aware of what's going on. Nothing was ever forthcoming. Bullying, debt collectors, court threats, court action, you name it, the full gamut. Everybody was trying to go after you and bully you into submission. Be a good slave. So why are you asking these questions, Mr. Schaefer? Get back in line and do what we tell you. Remember? So in 2012, we thought there is only one way to get to the bottom of this. We wanted to find out the truth. On the one hand, we had a bank or a finance company pretending that they had a right to make claims on a monthly basis to ask us for payments. Now, the whole world is under pressure at the moment. Many people have two, three, four different jobs just to make ends meet for the family. What if this whole structure is based on a complete lie? What would that mean for you as a family? Would you want to find out the truth? Well, we sure did. So we started asking these questions. Bank refused all the answers. At the end of 2012, we did one thing. We actually changed in the process of having a small increase done to an existing loan on our home. We changed the contract when that variation contract came through. We added a clause in there which compels the bank to provide the information we had sought all along and which was never provided. We gave them a cover sheet alerting them to the change and saying, okay, here it is. If you're happy with the small amendment, go ahead and please fund the increase, which was done. The bank accepted it. Did they read it? I don't know. Probably not. Within weeks, we started asking the pertinent questions relating back to the clauses in the contract that we now both had between each other. And again, the bank refused to answer any of the questions. So along the way, we told them that should they not provide the information we want, we would then freeze payments, lock it up until such time as they have basically fixed their reluctance to provide information. Then we would be happy to pay. At no time did we tell them, get stuff, we are not going to pay you. Of course, all we wanted was basic information. How was this loan actually set up? Was it legitimately? Was it as you had promised? By Christmas 2012, the bank ended up in breach. We sent them a notice of breach of agreement after three reminders had been ignored, basically. No information was forthcoming. At that time, we stopped making further payments. Within 2 months, the bank sent us a notice of default for non-payment and began pretty much instantly action in the Supreme Court in Western Australia 2 years ago. So over the last 2 years, we've had a fascinating learning curve and just most amazing period. What we have learned by now is that it appears, and I may be completely wrong, but it seems that the court and the banks are more than brothers. They are very close aligned. So right now it is in a point where for a period of 18 months, it was back and forth, back and forth. 2014, almost every other week, we had something to do down at the court in Perth. In August, the judge gave judgment against us for the bank, gave them a possession order, which meant that we would have to move out and hand over the property to these guys. By that time, they still had not brought any proof to the case. There's nothing on record that proves their claim. The court has admitted and recognized that they're in breach of agreement, deemed it non-interesting, non-important, still gave judgment, and at the same time they had also breached the National Credit Code at the highest level of penalties. Again, court recognised it, but it's deemed as not important enough to look into it. Let's quickly give judgment and get these guys out of my courtroom. That's the impression that we had all along. Where are we now? We're now in March 2015. The case is in the Court of Appeals, which is the very highest court, state court in Western Australia. So it's inside the Supreme Court, the Appeals Court. Currently, the appellant's case is in the system, yet to be heard in detail. There have been two prior hearings in the appeal, and some very interesting things have happened. Some of you may say, now that's unbelievable. Well, let me share that with you as well. So once the judge earlier had actually identified and suggested kind of a remedy to us by saying, well, that breach of agreement that, yes, I can see has happened, you could actually go and sue the bank directly. And also there could be some remedy there for their breach of the credit code, which has a penalty. In fact, that amounts to about $1.7 million in penalty points transferred over to dollars. Now that's three times the judgment amount. That alone should have brought the case to the point where the parties should have been able to sit down and say, hang on, yes, we admit breach, and it's openly admitted by the court and by the other side. However, completely ignored. So the remedy suggested was go and sue them. So we attempted to sue the bank in a fresh claim. Now guess what? The court denied access to the justice system by refusing acceptance of that claim. Instead, they said, oh, you must deal with it inside the running appeal, so we're not double dipping, basically. Sure, we then lodged another small application inside the appeal. We paid for that application. The matter got listed at a pre-existing hearing date, got added to that hearing. On the day, guess what? The court enthusiastically refused to hear the matter. Again, doesn't let us sue them, refuses to hear the matter. And in January, when they gave judgment on that interim application, they dismissed it. So really, we're at a point now where it apparently has no access for us into the justice system of Australia. Anyway, in this court, it appears that way. So right now, the appeal itself, we've actually lodged our appeal case, and I would encourage you and really invite you to go down on our website, freespeechaustralia.org, and take a cup of coffee and take the time to read the appeals case in detail. It's a 20-page document, very concise, and it tells you the last 2 years of action. You'll be amazed at what happened. Now, sure, that's written from our point of view, and the other side sees it very differently. And let me just put a disclaimer up front before I publish anything on this website. Firstly, I'm the author of this document. We, my wife and I, have written these papers in our time, on our table at home. We have removed any names, mentions, even of the case, of the other side, their lawyers, names that are mentioned throughout the document. We have blanked them out and basically sanitized this document to make sure that, firstly, you can't come after us for defamation because we haven't defamed you. And secondly, to be fair, we want to give them the opportunity to go public and rebut anything that we have brought into the light now, which may just simply be perceived by us and be incorrect. At the same time, of course, all the proof that the statements that we have made in the appellant's case and all the probably over 100 documents that have been filed in this matter now between the parties are fully substantiated. Dozens of affidavits, dozens of documents. There is plenty of information on the record. So where to go from here? Well, right now, I've just received an email. Today is March 17, and yet again, the court refused acceptance of an affidavit that we had filed, that I had filed, to highlight the point that we were denied access to the justice system. The court just refused acceptance of the filing of that affidavit. It took them 10 days to come back and tell me that. which interestingly is quite a lengthy time period, given that normally they take 1 or 2 days to do so. But that's okay. It falls in line with everything else that's happening down at the Supreme Court. In the meantime, we now convene a court of public opinion, because this, in our opinion, is quite downright disgusting what's happening here. We have a lender that for 2 years is in court, in our opinion, peddling a case that is frivolous, has no basis, and certainly no proof of what they claim to be true. So after 2 years, we think enough is enough. Now, either you bring the proof or you get the hell out of the court and stop abusing the court system. At the same time, though, the court seems to be playing along with them. Every single judicial officer, I believe there's been probably 10 that have handled a paper in our matter. Every single judicial officer seems to be, and again, I may be perceiving this just from my point of view slightly incorrectly. On the surface, it looks as if they're playing the ball into their court every single time to keep control over there. Now, we think as a law-abiding citizen in this country, we thought it would be very simple. We have a contract. Another party has breached a contract. Even though they start court action first, it should be a simple matter of bringing the two parties to the court, saying to the judge with all the materials proving it here, Your Honor, can you see this? They're actually in breach before they even started the claim. So they have what we call in law, unclean hands in equity. So to come to court with unclean hands, in our opinion, is a basic breach of underlying principles that courts like ours in this country should be based on. All these different points were simply ignored. Instead, the court says, now that's totally irrelevant. So let me see, Mr. Banker, what have you got? Oh, you are just like the other 30,000 cases estimated that come into our rooms around this country every year, and where we simply use the rubber stamp and say, judgment for the bank, hand over the keys. Well, we've learned earlier that the banks don't lend money. Should they even have the power to come into court and work with the judges and the judicial system to get their way? Are they not stealing all those 30,000 properties, farms, businesses, homes, putting people's lives into complete disarray? I don't want to be the judge of that. That's up to you to choose and think about. From what you've seen so far, we have a case in front of us right here, which is life in the current court system that everybody can now follow. Very simply, whatever happens, you'll hear about it. It will be transparently shared. A court of public opinion is just that. It is public, it's transparent, and it's in the open. Nothing will be hidden going forth. So the judges and the lawyers and the banks from now on can no longer hide. Even though I've removed all the names of the documents that are published below, I'm sure some of you are already smiling because you think, well, we know your surname, Mr. Schaefer. We can simply go to the Supreme Court website and do a search on their judgments and we'll find all the details of who the other party is. I'm sure some of you have worked that out already by now. I don't even have to tell you that, and I'm not. So I'm sorry, I can't hide it any further, Mr. Banker. So going forward right now, I think we will have a very interesting time together, openly in this case. What's going to happen next? Firstly, let me ask you a couple of questions. Question number one, what actually happened for this situation, I'm talking the global situation of humanity, to get this far? What did we do to allow ourselves to be turned into complete slaves? Where did we drop the ball? Where did we go wrong? That was question number one with sub-questions. Question number two, do you want to continue like this in your life? Are you willing to take this for the next 20 or 30 years, pushing your kids through a dumbing down education system that has one single purpose, to train them as good slaves and worker bees? Certainly I'm not, and neither is my wife. Third question, will you do something about it? When you make your next payment to these banks, think about it in detail. What if what this crazy German has actually said in his movie here is true? What if every single cent that I'm just giving to these banks right now is actually stolen right out of my pocket? Question number four, are you happy with your current situation? Deep down, have you ever felt that uneasy feeling that something can't be right? You know, heading down the freeway every morning in a box to drive to another box and go to work so you can earn money to pay for the box you drive in and the one you live in, that you go back to every night for a few hours? How paradox is this? If it's all built on this illusion and lie that money exists. Now, in our case, we did not bring an argument to the court about money creation from thin air. Underlying that is, of course, the premise of this whole conversation. What we brought to court is very simple. We have found documents and evidence that our claimant on the other side is not the party that provided the credit into the account on the day, which very simple in contract terms means they have not performed as they have promised. So every single one of their loans is invalid. So right now we are testing in the court system whether the judges are actually doing their job properly. Remember, they are public servants paid by us. A Supreme Court judge earns near $500,000 a year in our Supreme Court in Western Australia. Now that's what we see on the paper. The actions we have watched for the last 2 years raise very strong suspicions that there may be more than that off the record. Now again, that is a possibly preposterous, scurrilous allegation, as I have been called in the past by the judges. I don't have proof for that. It is very apparent that things aren't what they need to be and what they should be. 2 years of wasting public funds in this court. One single document would have actually substantiated the case. Instead, we have a barrister on the other side saying, oh, even if they haven't brought their funds on the day, as you say, Mr. Schaefer, it makes no difference. We can still claim. Really? Let me invite you to be part of this. Let's bring this out in such a massive way that the court system won't know what hit them. We want to have this out seen by millions of people. It is time, and the time is now. 2015 is the time and the year of the people. We've all had enough of this bullshit. So let's shine the biggest torch up the ass of the banks and the judges and make them do the job that they have actually pledged and sworn an oath or taken an affirmative oath to serve the people and justice in a true and neutral manner. The time is now for them to do that. Now, we've created a simple t-shirt which is called What Is? Bring that in here. What is fountain pen money? Doesn't say much, but it says a lot. Now, we encourage you and invite you just to grab a couple of those t-shirts. Wear them. Go to work, wear them at parties. Wear them, give them as gifts, and start conversations. Use these things as cage rattlers. It is time. That cage needs to be rattled. Firstly, if you haven't rattled your own cage, maybe you want to do that. It's probably going to be very challenging. Remember the questions I asked you? Are you really happy with what you're doing every day? Now that you know what's probably behind it and forcing you to the shackles every day of your life, let me just go back and put this one back on. It will be very challenging. You are going to be challenging your most deepest-seated belief systems of how life works. You can ignore that and just continue, go down the path and look at it again in a year's time or in 2 years' time. at the same time right now, you have an opportunity to look at it square on and say, well, this is not right. We need to fix this. This is our children's future. This is my own future. I don't like working with somebody that stands behind me with a rubber glove and some Vaseline every day of the week. I've had enough. So let's put this to the test in the public, for the public to see. I welcome all the judicial officers, I welcome all the legal representatives, and I welcome your bankers to take notice of what's happening. We're all part of this together. This year we will change it. So grab some of these t-shirts, rattle some cages, start those conversations, and go crazy in sharing all this information that is put out here. Yeah? We're very privileged to be able to do this and to have come this far in our struggle in the court, which by far is no longer a fight. This has turned from a fight against a fictitious lender long time already. This has turned to a principled stand that we have made as a family. Time is here. Let's do it. Thanks, guys.